Hey, everybody, what's going on? I am Greg Sussman, joined today by our own Frank Stanfill, who's here to look at the waiver wire as we head into week 15. Frankie, what's happening?
Not much, Greggy. I hope everyone's still alive in their fantasy football playoffs. Injuries, and more injuries. Week 14 was just filled with a bunch of them, and we will talk about that a lot here on The Hurry Up.
We begin at the quarterback position where, well, there's no real injuries, but some tough matchups for week 15. Frank asked me earlier, he's like, hey, anyone actually start these guys? My answer was yes. I'm not starting Matt Ryan in San Francisco, so I need a new quarterback, Frank. So where should I turn?
Well, Greg, I'm happy that you finally wised up. You're not using Matt Ryan heading into week 15, and you're right. There's a few other quarterbacks with really tough matchups. Dak Prescott, Kirk Cousins, and Sam Darnold all come to mind as well. We're going over to the Minshew mustache. We are back, baby, and he has not played well recently since he has become the starting quarterback of the Jacksonville Jaguars once again, but he has the remedy for that in week 15, and that's going up against the Oakland Raiders. This defense reminded us how bad they were just yesterday against Ryan Tannehill and the Tennessee Titans. Ryan Tannehill throws for 391 yards and 3 touchdowns against this defense. They don't get pressure. Their secondary is terrible as well. They're allowing 284 passing yards per game. That is the fourth most in the league. And they are one of three defenses that have allowed 30 passing touchdowns this season. They've also allowed the most 40-plus yard receptions and 20-plus yard receptions. So that secondary is a very bad one. And I think the Jacksonville Jaguars, while DJ Chark, another injury that they're dealing with, they do have some players that can make plays. They've also allowed 3 rushing touchdowns to quarterbacks. We know that Gardner Minshew can run a little bit. He has 28 or more rushing yards in 6 games so far this season. Both defenses are bad. I think we get some back and forth here between the Oakland Raiders and the Jacksonville Jaguars. If you are worried about those tough matchups, this is one of the best ones that you can have heading into Week 15. We're going with the stash.
Minshew Mania driving us into the semifinals, baby. Let's rock and roll. Gardner Minshew in a great matchup on Sunday. But if you're a little scared off and you don't want to go with Gardner Minshew, Frank mentioned a couple of other options, but those aren't necessarily available on your waiver wire. Frank, who is another quarterback that we can grab instead?
Well, I spoke about Ryan Fitzpatrick last week, Greg, going up against the New York Jets, and he did disappoint us in Week 14. Hopefully that didn't cost you your fantasy football playoff matchup. But he's going right back to MetLife Stadium in Week 15 against the New York Giants. Again, one of the worst secondaries in the league here. Ryan Fitzpatrick did not throw for a touchdown against the Jets in Week 14, but he did add a season-high 65 rushing yards. You know that he'll make a few plays with his legs. He has some rushing touchdowns this year as well. But the volume will always be there for Ryan Fitzpatrick. I talked about this last week when I was talking up his matchup against the New York Jets. Their defense is so bad, the Miami Dolphins, that allows them to get into shootouts with opposing teams, and they can't run the football either. I mean, he was their leading rusher yesterday. I know that everyone's all over Patrick Laird, but Ryan Fitzpatrick led this team in rushing yards, so they can't run, and their defense is terrible. That leads to volume for Ryan Fitzpatrick, which is very good against the New York Giants. Greg, I know that you're a Giants fan. You've watched them all season long. You know how bad this secondary truly is. They've allowed some really big games in fantasy this year. They've allowed 3-plus passing touchdowns in a game on 5 different occasions. We're recording this before Monday Night Football. That number might be 6 by the end of Week 14 with Carson Wentz with a good matchup here as well. The Giants allowing the 7th most fantasy points to quarterbacks so far this season. We got a 47.5 total heading into Week 15 in this game. That is tied for the fourth highest on the slate according to the FanDuel Sportsbook. So I expect some points. I expect volume for Ryan Fitzpatrick. It's another really good matchup for him.
Nobody knows how bad the Giants are like I do, Frank, and Ryan Fitzpatrick is in a great spot on Sunday to dominate a brutal Giants secondary. Both Minshew and Fitzpatrick, they're usable both in Weeks 15 and 16, which is why I like them both here this weekend. Let's move on to the running back position, where Adrian Peterson is once again the starter in Washington, as Darius Geis goes down with a knee injury, which should keep him out for the rest of the year, which means all day, he's back on the fantasy waiver wire and back as someone that we could start in our fantasy playoffs. How much are you trusting AP here this week?
I think AP is going to check in as a low-end RB2, high-end flex option heading into Week 15. It's a tougher matchup against the Philadelphia Eagles, but the volume should be there. You mentioned Darius Geis. He's going for an MRI on his knee. Looks like he has an MCL sprain in the same knee that he tore his ACL last year during the preseason. So Adrian Peterson, again, should see that volume. He played 28 snaps in Week 14, his most since Week 9 against the Buffalo Bills. He had 20 rushing attempts for 76 yards and a touchdown. And if you remember, in the games before Darius Geis returned, there was four games in a row where AP saw big volume. He was averaging 18.8 carries per game and 95.8 rushing attempts in some really tough matchups. You know, he did that against the Minnesota Vikings. He did that against the 49ers as well. So that's why I don't really worry much about this Philadelphia Eagles matchup heading into week 15. He really is the only running back that is going to see carries. Chris Thompson has been on the field, but they have proven that when they want to run the football, it's going to be with Adrian Peterson. We know that Bill Callahan does not want Dwayne Haskins throwing the ball all that much. So I think that this is going to lead to, again, 15 to 20 carries for Adrian Peterson, tougher matchup, but I think that puts him on our radar as a low-end RB2 and high-end RB3. You know, Gregg, what better way would it be for Adrian Peterson to pay homage to his fantasy owners, right, for everything he's done for us in his career than to go out there and win us some fantasy football playoff matchups? I think he'll do just that.
Bill Callahan has said, I want to run the football ever since he took over for Jay Gruden midway through this year, whether it's been Darius Geis or Adrian Peterson. That's exactly what he does. And even against Green Bay in a matchup they shouldn't have been able to run the ball successfully, they did. Adrian Peterson, very much on our radar here this weekend. But if you don't like the old guard with AP, you can go with someone younger, like DeAndre Washington of Oakland. Josh Jacobs has his fractured shoulder, and he didn't play this past week. DeAndre Washington started and found the end zone. Can he do it again this Sunday, Frank?
There is a very high probability that DeAndre Washington will be able to do just that as he's going up against the Jacksonville Jaguars, who have just been getting shredded on the ground. More on that in a little bit. You mentioned Josh Jacobs dealing with this fractured shoulder, did not play in week 14. Considering the Oakland Raiders have lost three in a row and they're really falling out of contention, I don't know that they're going to try and rush back their rookie phenom running back. So I think that we could be in play for DeAndre Washington starting again for the Oakland Raiders heading into week 15. He led this backfield against the Titans with 39 offensive snaps. He had 14 carries, 53 rushing yards, and a rushing touchdown. As you mentioned, he led the team with 7 targets and 6 receptions. Where was this all season long for Josh Jacobs? We were pounding the table, wishing that John Gruden would get him involved in the pass game, but DeAndre Washington did just that. He had 43 receiving yards as well. You know, all of those receiving totals, the 7 targets, 6 receptions, 43 receiving yards, were all higher than anything Josh Jacobs had done in a single game all season. So if they're going to use DeAndre Washington in that regard, that just raises his ceiling as well for fantasy football. Oakland has an elite offensive line. They are third in run blocking, according to Football Outsiders. This matchup against the Jacksonville Jaguars, this does not get any better. This is not an exaggeration either. They just allowed 297 total yards and 2 touchdowns to Melvin Gordon and Austin Eckler in week 14. They even let their fullback Derek Watt score a rushing touchdown as well. This Jaguars defense is just atrocious right now. They've allowed 8 rushing touchdowns over their last 4 games. If Josh Jacobs cannot go, DeAndre Washington is a legit high-end RB2 in this matchup.
Without Josh Jacobs, DeAndre Washington is a must-start here this week in a tasty matchup against Jacksonville. As Frank said, doesn't get better than this. So take advantage and get DeAndre Washington into your lineup. Let's go back to the wide receivers, Frank, where we've been telling you for a month that it's A.J. Brown time. The phenomenal one, he doesn't stop rolling. We love Ryan Tannehill, and his favorite receiver is clearly A.J. Brown.
I never thought I would say this, Gregg, but I want as many shares of this Tennessee Titans offense as I could possibly get right now. They are absolutely rolling, and you're right. A.J. Brown is the number one target in this Titans offense. He has been inconsistent, but we know what the upside is. He just put together 5 receptions for 153 yards and 2 touchdowns. He hasn't put together 2 good fantasy games in a row, but his ownership percentage in season-long leagues is still way too low based on this upside, and they have a huge game against the Houston Texans in Week 15, a game that has a 50-point total, according to the FanDuel Sportsbook. That is the highest total as of now in Week 15. That's a huge game for, you know, the breakdown of the AFC South and the way things that are going to, you know, come out of that division here. So we've got a huge game, a competitive game, a huge point total there in that one. Like Ryan Tannehill, you know, A.J. Brown has been extremely efficient. He is top 7 among wide receivers in yards per reception, yards per target, and yards per route run. So the efficiency is there for him. The upside is there for him. The Texans have been better recently against wide receivers, but they did just allow 3 passing touchdowns to Drew Lock. 2 of those went to tight ends. But we've seen some big games out of wide receivers against the Houston Texans so far this season. The Tennessee Titans offense, 31 points scored in 4 straight games, at least 31. They're averaging 37.5 points per game. I want shares of this offense, Gregg, and A.J. Brown is the top receiver in this offense.
We never thought of the Titans' offense as high-flying or powerful, but that's exactly what it's been with Ryan Tannehill. It's been awesome. A.J. Brown's been the primary recipient. Get A.J. Brown off the waiver wire and into your lineups in your semifinals here in Week 15. Up next, another wide receiver that's worth picking up. It's in Miami, where Allen Hurns is going to step up as potentially the number one wide receiver in Ryan Fitzpatrick's high-flying Dolphins offense. Devontae Parker got concussed early in Week 14. We know Preston Williams is out for the season, which means Allen Hurns, the next man up.
Yeah, we'll have to pay attention to what's going on with Devontae Parker. Left that game with a concussion and was visibly woozy when he was getting up. So pay attention to that, but if he can't go, Allen Hurns is the next wide receiver up. He led the Dolphins wide receivers in offensive snaps in Week 14. Also had 8 targets, 23% of the target share, had 5 catches for 68 yards. We know who Allen Hurns is at this point. You know, he's not a huge upside wide receiver. We kind of, you know, he's settled into his role in the NFL, but in a good matchup against the New York Giants, if we like Ryan Fitzpatrick, we have to like who he's throwing the ball to. Again, they can't run the ball, and Mike Gesicki let us down in Week 14. That sucks. But outside of that, it's Allen Hurns and Isaiah Ford. Isaiah Ford, who had a solid game as well, but I would lean with Hurns because he has had a more consistent role with this Miami Dolphins team the past couple of weeks. He's really stepped up as their wide receiver two here. And if there's no Devontae Parker, I would expect him to be the wide receiver one. The Giants, again, their secondary is just garbage this season, allowing the second most fantasy points to opposing wide receivers. They have allowed 18 touchdowns to wide receivers. That is the third most this season. So if you need a wide receiver with all these injuries going down, if you were relying on Devontae Parker, you might be desperate. Allen Hurns is the guy in a good matchup against the New York Giants.
If you're desperate, Allen Hurns could work in this spot. Again, it's against the New York Giants. Doesn't get much better than that. Allen Hurns, pay attention to the injury report. He was targeted a lot this weekend, and hopefully will be again here in Week 15. Let's move on over to the tight ends, and there's a lot of good streaming tight ends. You don't say that often, but this week, it's true. We start in Carolina, where Ian Thomas scored a touchdown without Greg Olsen in there. I don't know if Greg Olsen will be out again. You got to check the injury report for that, but if he is, Ian Thomas works.
Well, Greg, there are a lot of tight ends that we perceive to be good streams, but they don't always come through. I think Ian Thomas is one that actually could come through for us in Week 15, assuming that Greg Olsen is out. And it looks like the Carolina Panthers are clearly falling out of contention here. They fired their head coach, Ron Rivera. I'm not sure that they're going to be rushing Greg Olsen to get back in here. And now this is 2 seasons in a row where late in the season, Ian Thomas has come through for both the Panthers and for fantasy owners. He played on 86% of the snaps this past week. He ran 45 routes on 54 Kyle Allen dropbacks. Finished the game with 5 receptions for 57 yards and a touchdown on 10 targets. 24% of the target share. Second on the team. 31% of the air yards for the Carolina Panthers. That was first on the team this past week. And Seattle Seahawks, they've allowed a ton of production to tight ends this season in terms of fantasy football. They're allowing the second most fantasy points to the position. We just saw Tyler Higbee put up 116 yards this past week. Last week, in Week 13, Kyle Rudolph scored a touchdown against the Seattle Seahawks defense. So the Carolina Panthers defense has been terrible. They're playing from behind. They need to throw the ball to someone. And it seems like Kyle Allen does have a rapport with Ian Thomas. Based on his targets and the matchup, I think that Ian Thomas is going to be a really, really good play in Week 15, Greg.
A lot to like about Ian Thomas here in Week 15. So make sure you get him out there. Put him in your lineup and feel confident starting him for now. If you don't like Ian Thomas, you want to go with another option, well, you always look to who's playing the Cardinals. This week, it's the Cleveland Browns, and David Njoku's back in the lineup, Frankie.
Yeah, I don't feel nearly as confident about David Njoku as I do Ian Thomas. While I love the matchup for Njoku, he just returned this past week. He only played 20 snaps and ran 9 routes in Week 14. Perhaps they, you know, up his workload a little bit more moving forward. But, yeah, look, this is all about the matchup against the Arizona Cardinals. They're allowing the most fantasy points to opposing tight ends by far. It's not close. Unfortunately, Vance McDonald couldn't take advantage of that. He left with an injury in Week 14. But they've allowed 13 touchdowns. That's the most at the position as well. Odell Beckham is dealing with a groin injury. Might be playing through a sports hernia as well. Jarvis Landry has been the one guy that Baker Mayfield can rely on. And we've seen some inconsistent play out of the tight end. But they have been used throughout the course of the season for the Cleveland Browns. You know, Ricky Seals-Jones has randomly popped up here and there. I think that they need another pass catcher to step up here. I think we could actually get some points in this game. Some back and forth between Baker Mayfield and Kyler Murray. So if you ask me, obviously, great matchup here. I think we start to see the workload increase a little bit more here for David Njoku. So He is one of those streaming tight ends we're looking at heading into week 15, Gregg.
David Njoku, you don't feel all that confident, but again, when it's Arizona, you feel better than normal. And David Njoku fits the bill. He's exciting. He has the right matchup. And Odell Beckham not being 100% makes you want to put Njoku in your lineup if you're desperate here in week 15. Finally, before we wrap up, let's go to a streaming defense for week 15, Frankie. And we were both right with all of our calls last week when it came to the defense, so let's get it right again. Who do you like here this week?
It's the Seattle Seahawks going up against the Carolina Panthers in Carolina. Normally, we like to grab some home defenses here, but I think you can't argue with what the Panthers are doing right now. Spoke about a little bit when we mentioned Ian Thomas earlier, but this team is really falling apart right now. They've been turning the ball over a lot. It seems like, you know, they fired their head coach, Ron Rivera. What is this team playing for? And the Seattle Seahawks have actually been really good from a fantasy perspective for their defense. They have 11 or more fantasy points in three of the last four games. They don't get a lot of pass rush. You know, they don't get a lot of sacks, but they have been very opportunistic. They have 6 interceptions and 7 fumble recoveries during that 4-game stretch. Kyle Allen does have 12 interceptions on the season as well. I would expect the Carolina Panthers to be, you know, chasing points or at least in a competitive environment here, which means we should see some more dropbacks for Kyle Allen, which should lead to some more interceptions, some more fumbles. So based on the way the Seattle Seahawks are playing and based on how badly the Carolina Panthers offense has been, Gregg, I think that this is a good spot for their defense.
Against the Carolina Panthers and turnover machine Kyle Allen, who will start once again for Carolina. Seattle in a good spot to make up what happened on Sunday Night Football against the Rams. Seattle's defense still put up enough points to help you out in fantasy leagues, and against Carolina, it will only be better. That's going to do it for us here on the FanDuel. Hurry up, enjoy Monday Night Football tonight. I'll be back here tomorrow as we take a look at NBA DFS with Tom Vecchio right here on the FanDuel. Hurry up. Have a great night, and we'll see you tomorrow.